It is 6:30 p.m. on April 4th, 2017. I'll call to order the business meeting of the Laramie City Council. First item on the agenda is the Pledge of Allegiance. Would you all rise and join me?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
City Clerk, can you please do roll call?
Gabriel.
Here.
Hanson.
Here.
Henry.
Here.
McKinney. Absent. Palikas.
Here.
Shumway.
Here.
Schuster.
Here.
Pierce.
Here.
Somerville.
Here.
That is 8 present and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you very much. So next item on the agenda is proclamations and presentations, and we have 3 proclamations tonight. So I'm going to start off the first one for Sexual Assault Awareness Month. Whereas April serves as an opportunity to renew our commitment to preventing sexual assault and assisting those who suffer from those crimes against them, and whereas rape, sexual assault, and sexual harassment impact our community as seen by statistics, indicating that 1 in 5 women and 1 in 16 men will have experienced sexual assault by the time they complete college, and whereas we must work together to educate our community about what has been done to prevent sexual assault and how to support survivors. And whereas, on average, there are more than 300,000 victims of rape and sexual assault each year in the United States. And whereas, sexual assault is a serious crime that affects people of all races, ages, income levels, genders, and sexualities. And whereas, with leadership, dedication, and encouragement, there is compelling evidence that we can be successful in reducing sexual violence through prevention, education, increased awareness, and holding perpetrators who commit acts of violence responsible for their actions. And whereas, in addition to the immediate physical and emotional costs, sexual assault may also have associated consequences of post-traumatic stress disorder, substance abuse, major depression, homelessness, eating disorders, and suicide. And whereas, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention have identified sexual assault as a significant, costly, and preventable health issue. And whereas, a coalition of organizations such as law enforcement officials, those involved with shelters and hotline services, healthcare providers, the clergy, and other concerned citizens has emerged to directly confront this crisis and are helping in the effort to end sexual assault. We must recognize the compassion and dedication of these volunteers and professionals, applaud their efforts, and increase public understanding of this important problem. And whereas, only a coordinated community effort will put a stop to this crime. Therefore, be it resolved that I, Andrea Somerville, Mayor of Laramie, Wyoming, do hereby proclaim April 2017 as Sexual Assault Awareness Month and urge all citizens to recognize and participate in preventing sexual assault and incorporate this into their daily lives. So with that, I believe we have a representative here from the SAFE Project, Mr. Scott Cheney, if you'd like to say a few words.
Madam Mayor, Council. My name is Scott Cheney. I'm the Outreach Coordinator for Albany County Safe Project. We are a nonprofit that has served this community for over 30 years. And sexual assault is something that we try very hard to prevent. In rural states such as Wyoming, it has historically been very underreported and paid attention to. So we want to thank you very much for acknowledging this and accepting our proclamation. It's one step in many to help prevent the crime and to help address it. Thank you.
I appreciate that. If you'll come forward and I'll give you the proclamation. We appreciate everything the program and all the efforts and volunteers do here in this college community. So thank you very much. I appreciate it. So our next proclamation is going to be for national service. Whereas service to others is a hallmark of the American character and central to how we meet our challenges, and whereas the nation's cities are increasingly turning to national service and volunteerism as a cost-effective strategy to meet their needs. And whereas AmeriCorps, VISTA, and Senior Corps participants address the most pressing challenges facing our communities, from educating students for their jobs of the 21st century and supporting veterans and military families, to providing health services and helping communities recover from natural disasters. And whereas national service expands economic opportunity by creating more sustainable, resilient communities and providing education, career skills, and leadership abilities for those who serve. And whereas AmeriCorps, Vista, and Senior Corps participants serve in more than 50,000 locations across the country, bolstering the civic, neighborhood, and faith-based organizations that are so vital to our economic and social well-being. And whereas national service participants increase the impact of their organizations they serve, both through their direct service and by managing millions of additional volunteers. And whereas national service represents a unique public-private partnership that invests in community solutions and leverages non-federal resources to strengthen community impact and increase the return on taxpayer dollars. And whereas national service participants demonstrate commitment, dedication, and patriotism by making an intensive commitment to service, a commitment that remains with them in their future endeavors. And whereas the Corporation for National and Community Service shares a priority with the county officials and mayors nationwide to engage citizens, improve lives, and strengthen communities, and is joining with the National League of Cities, the National Association of Counties, Cities of Service, and mayors and counties across the country for the Mayor and County Recognition Day for National Service on April 4th, 2017. Whereas National Service volunteers currently serve the Laramie community with the Wyoming Conservation Corps, the Wyoming Coalition Against Domestic Violence and Sexual Assault, Greater Wyoming Big Brothers Big Sisters, Feeding Laramie Valley, Foster Grandparents of the Wyoming Rockies, which is Senior Corps, the Laramie Soup Kitchen, Southern Wyoming Retired and Senior Volunteer Program, and the Wyoming Senior Companion Program. Therefore, be it resolved that I, Andrea Somerville, Mayor of Laramie, Wyoming, do hereby proclaim April 4th, 2017 as National Service Recognition Day and encourage residents to recognize the positive impact of national service in our county and to thank those who serve and to find ways to give back to their communities. Now, I know we have numerous representation for these committees that are here, and I'd like to ask everybody to come up. We all know that Laramie has a great history with volunteerism, and it's very evident in our community and all of our everyday lives. So please come up. So I'm going to present the proclamation to you here.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So they want to do a picture with the council, and then we'll let them speak a little bit, if that's okay. Come up, guys.
Do you want us to come around?
Yeah.
Sounds good.
They want us down there.
We're just going to stand where we're at. How's that? Yep.
Squeeze.
One,
big
old.
Squeeze
in.
Oh, there are a lot of them.
There are a lot of them. Yep.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I wonder if maybe you should be the best in
front, maybe. Tall people in the back, shorter people to the front.
Representative that wants to say a few words, please do so, and we'll put the podium back up.
If it doesn't bother you if I talk from right here, I'll just do that before we move it. I'd like to thank you, Madam Mayor, thank you, and to the rest of the council. Laramie's a wonderful community to do national service in. Both, you know, the citizens of the community and, you know, folks like you are incredibly supportive of the efforts we do. As you can see by all the people in the room, a very small percentage of the folks in this town that are actually actively doing national service at the moment. And without, you know, people like you, this wouldn't be possible. So I really do want to extend a real thank you to you guys, and just, you know, keep your eyes out. We'll be in the community. So thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, our third and final proclamation tonight is for Community Cleanup Day. Whereas the City of Laramie residents are proud of their community and enjoy the natural beauty of Laramie, and whereas Laramie and its surrounding area is also appreciated and enjoyed by everyone who visits here, and whereas the community has recognized the benefits of maintaining the pristine quality of Laramie, and whereas cleaning up the city safeguards health, reduces potential fire hazard, enhances the attractiveness of Laramie, and stimulates public pride, and whereas a clean community is more attractive to residents and visitors to live, work, and play in, And whereas the Laramie Community Cleanup was initiated by the Chamber of Commerce along with the Beautification Committee. And whereas the Laramie Community Cleanup Day is an opportunity for citizens and organizations to express community pride and bring people together for a common purpose to help beautify Laramie for both visitors and residents. And whereas, in addition, the City of Laramie, the Laramie Chamber Business Alliance, the Laramie Boomerang, and many others are proud to sponsor this event. Now, therefore, I, Andy Somerville, Mayor of Laramie, do hereby proclaim April 22nd, 2017, as Community Cleanup Day. And throughout the city, and encourage individuals, families, neighbors, friends of Laramie to come out and work together to clean up personal property, join with neighbors to complete a neighborhood project, or join the citywide cleanup with the central meeting point at City Hall, 406 Ivinson Avenue, starting at 7:30 a.m. And with that, I invite our code enforcement officer, Brian Forrester, to come up.
Thank you. Honorable Mayor and City Council, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to lead this event and for your continued support. I do appreciate the City Council's support, but I'd like to thank the citizens of Laramie for making this a success. You know, last year we had roughly 480 people. We're looking for 500, 600, 1,000. Let's do it.
Sounds great. And I will add that I know some council members will be on hand to cook food for everybody that comes to County Community Cleanup Day, if you're interested in that kind of thing. Cool. So we'll have it around City Hall again?
Yes.
Okay. Fair enough. Sounds good. We'll come up and get your proclamation.
Your Honor, there is a reward. Everybody gets fed at noontime.
That's right.
That's yes. Very true. Thank you for your efforts in leading this and putting it on for the community. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, Brian. All right. City staff, do we have any announcements this evening?
Mayor, one announcement from Public Works.
Okay. City Engineer Winkler.
Honorable Mayor, members of the City Council, just wanted to take this chance to give you a quick update on the Harney Street Bridge project and some traffic control that they're planning to implement. YDOT, along with S&S Builders, the contractor for the project, they are looking to shut down Snowy Range Road west of Cedar Street. This closure is going to start, or is scheduled to start, on Monday the 10th. And it will last until August, into August. During this time, they are planning to construct the new roadway alignment for Snowy Range Road that will eventually connect to the new structure at Harney Street. YDOT, along with their contractor, will monitor the situation as far as traffic control goes and make adjustments as needed. So just wanted to give everybody the chance to
appreciate that. Councilor Schuster?
So Cedar at the stoplight clear to I-80 or
just to the east of Garfield Street.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yep. So
thank you very much. I appreciate
yep.
it.
Yep.
Next item on our agenda is disclosures by City Council members. Do we have any conflicts of interest or disclosures need to be made by City Council members for items on our agenda this evening? Okay, seeing none, move to the agenda, and I'll turn it over to the Vice Mayor.
Okay, I move that the following changes to the agenda be approved. This evening we have two changes from the consent agenda. Item 8H is moving to item on the regular agenda, 11A. And our second change, we are adding an item to our regular agenda. It's going to be item 9A. It has to do with federal funding for the airport.
Second.
Second by Councilor Shumway. All of those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Any opposed? That motion carries. Vice Mayor.
Okay, I move that the agenda be set as changed.
Second.
Second by Councilor Henry. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Any opposed? That motion carries. Vice Mayor.
Okay, I move that the consent agenda be approved and that each specific action on the consent agenda be approved as indicated.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Schuster. City Clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Gabriel.
Yes.
Hansen.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
McKinney, absent. Palikas.
Yes.
Shumway.
Yes.
Schuster.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's eight yeses, zero noes, and one absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Moving on to the regular agenda, item number 9A, Councilor Gabriel.
Thank you, Mayor. I would move for approval of Resolution 2017-26. This is the joint resolution between the City of Laramie and Albany County supporting the Essential Air Service Program.
Second.
Second by Vice Mayor Pierce. Do we have a representative from the airport that would like to speak to this? Mr. Skinner, welcome.
Thank you. Honorable Mayor, members of the council, my name is Jack Skinner. I'm the airport manager. Along with me to offer support, I've got two members of the airport board, Tim Stamp, who's the current chairman, and Wes Bressler, who's the treasurer of the airport board. And then to also offer support and answer any questions regarding economic development and the airport is J.J. Harris with the Laramie Business Alliance. So what you have before you this evening is a request by the airport board for the passage of this resolution to support the Essential Air Service Program and to notify with this signing of this resolution, we would take it and get it to all of our congressional delegation in Washington, D.C. to offer support. I'm available to answer any questions about the program or this resolution.
Questions from council?
Your Honor, I just have a suggestion, since the public hasn't seen this document, that we at least read the section 1 and 2 of the resolution at the end, what it's all about.
Sure, I would be happy to do that.
Okay, please.
So this resolution is to support the Essential Air Service Program. In section 1, it says the Laramie City Council and Albany County Commission of Wyoming do resolve. Number 1 is that Laramie City Council and Albany County Commission do declare that commercial air service to the Laramie Regional Airport to be critical infrastructure necessary to the city and county's future. And section 2 is that the Laramie City Council and Albany County Commission request Wyoming's elected federal delegation to support the EAS program and funding.
Thank you, Your Honor.
And the county did pass this resolution this morning.
Councilor Gabriel.
Thank you, Mayor. Jack, in our conversations, you mentioned that you've talked with the delegation, and in the past, this has also come up for discussion, but it's always been passed. And so you feel fairly comfortable that even though it's proposed to be cut in the federal budget, that hopefully with support from the city and county and your meetings with the delegation, that it will be reinforced and hopefully funded once again.
Yes, in the past it's been up for elimination, and it's always we've always received good support from our delegation, and there's other rural communities, other rural states that rely on this program also, and it's always received strong support from those rural states. Yeah, I will tell you that this is concerning, but I'm optimistic that it will get funded again.
Councilor Schuster.
Thank you. As being a former liaison to the board, just some questions so that the public knows what's going on here. If we do not keep this funding, how many flights will we lose a week off of our airport, do you estimate?
Sure. So the EAS program funds 12 flights per week, and that's all the flights that we have. It's two round trips to Denver per weekday, and then one round trip to Denver per weekend day. So 12 flights a week. And the subsidy, I think a lot of people misunderstand it. They think the subsidy comes to the airport. It does not come to the airport. It goes directly to the airline, SkyWest Airline. And there are 112 communities throughout the United States, the lower 48 states that receive funding like this, airlines that receive funding.
Councilor Schuster, please.
And to continue, I hate to say we battle with people just driving to Denver and parking their cars in storage and all this. If this happens, approximately how much would a person's ticket go up without these subsidies for them to try to fly out of Laramie?
That's a hard one to answer, actually. I mean, right now, the per passenger subsidy for Laramie is $71. Those are folks going to Denver and those and those coming back also. So $71 is the per passenger subsidy. You know, I can't say that that's what the ticket prices would go up by.
But approximately.
Yeah.
So somebody flying round trip would have $142 at least increase in contribution.
Correct.
Which would probably just terrify us because people would be then driving to another community to fly out of.
Yeah, you know, a lot these airlines rely on this kind of subsidy to serve these rural communities.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Hanson.
Mr. Skinner, I have just a question. We've heard, of course, that recently boardings have increased, and I think we're above 10,000, if I'm not mistaken.
Closer to 15,000 now.
15,000. And my question was, that has always been sort of a threshold and hasn't had an impact on the funding. Is that still the case, or is the scenario now different that this wonderful news that we have such high boarding numbers has any impact or no impact on the decision in Washington?
Yeah, they kind of go hand in hand with the air service and the successful air service and the quality air service that we're receiving now, and people are have confidence in this airline. They're using it more, and therefore that returns dollars in the form of capital improvement grants to the airport, $1 million a year, and those are 93.75% federal funds that come back into this community in the form of capital improvement projects like runways and taxiways and terminal buildings, those types of things. So it's a huge economic impact to the airport and the community.
So this could also be affected by this?
Oh, yes.
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 I think that's important to observe.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Harris, I'm going to talk a little bit about the economic impact.
J.J. Harris, Mayor, Council members, thank you for listening to me. I'll be brief. I know you've got a long evening. The overall impact the airport has on the last study is about $38 million. They have 7 employees and 6 full-time TSA agents there. That's significant, and that generates from our hotels, Hertz Rent-A-Car, Enterprise Rent-A-Car, to Snowy Range, Albany Lodge, all the people that come through tourism, and it touches every one of us. To our companies getting in, out, and us recruiting businesses, so we thank you for your support. The LCBA supports us strongly, along with the Third Street Project. thank you for your continued economic development efforts in the community and leading the charge on this. Any questions?
Any questions for Mr. Harris? Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Any comments from the public on this? Comments from council on this? I just want to add that as the current airport liaison, I can tell you there are numerous activities that are going on at the airport. If we were to lose commercial service here, it would certainly help it would hurt the private planes that are going in and out, because it would be much harder for the airport to sustain its operation. And I certainly cannot imagine having the state's only 4-year institution out here without access to air service. That just, to me, would be an enigma. So I appreciate support on this resolution. Any other comments? All right, City Clerk, can you do a roll call, please?
Gabriel.
Yes.
Hanson.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
McKinney, absent. Palikas.
Yes.
Shumway.
Yes.
Schuster.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 9 yes, 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. All right, on to our next item. Item number 10, Councilor Palikas.
Thank you. This is a bid for the Mill Street Improvement Project, and it would read as follows. I move to award the bid for the Mill Street Improvement Project to Simon Contractors, Laramie, Wyoming, in the amount of $582,692.46, along with a contingency of $87,403.87, for a total amount of $670,096.33, to approve the contract and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign.
Second.
Second by Councilor Schuster. City staff, Engineer Winkler.
Honorable Mayor, members of the council, along with the goal for to maintain citywide infrastructure, sanitary sewers, water lines, all that, the Mill Street Improvement Project will upgrade approximately 1,065 linear feet of water line and 894 feet of existing sanitary sewer between 13th Street and 10th Street on Mill Street. So along with this, we will also be doing roadway improvements. There will be new asphalt, curb, gutter, sidewalks, ADA accessibility. And according to, or as per the purchasing policies, this project was bid on March 14th. We received three bids. Simon Contractors was the apparent low bidder. Prior to the bid, the day before the bid, it was brought to staff's attention that there were a couple of omissions in our bid quantities. And that was after our time of making corrections through addendums. So after the bids were received and the low bidder was acknowledged, it was all then negotiated that an additional $7,750 was needed to cover the quantities for base and sub-base underneath the curb and gutter and some minor omissions there. You'll note that the staff is requesting 15% contingency on this job. That is to address this job is one that we've had actually on the shelf for just a little while before we could get it out to bid. So there are some concerns with the quantities and different things like that, like what we noticed as we went into the, or we was brought to our attention by the contractors. With that, we are looking to utilize enterprise funds, both water, wastewater, and then we are using SPT funds to fund the street portions of this project. So the total amount of the project will be, with contingency, $670,096.33.
Questions? Councilor Hanson?
Thank you. Is it my understanding that these are main lines rather than, you know, that connect to other lines so that they are really essential to be replaced because they are, what do you call them?
Transmission lines?
Transmission lines.
These are not transmission lines. These are water, these are mains that provide services to each residence.
To each residence.
Yes. So.
Sewer as well as water.
Sewer as well.
Thank you.
Yes.
Other questions? All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Any comments from the public on this item? Comments from council? City clerk, can you do roll call, please?
Palikas.
Yes.
Shumway.
Yes.
Schuster.
Yes.
McKinney absent. Henry.
Yes.
Hanson.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. Item number 11, Councilor Henry.
Yes, I move to approve of City Council Resolution 2017-25, certifying Planning Commission action regarding 321 3rd Street, an action plan for enhancing 3rd Street by 2020 as an official plan for the city, based on findings of fact and conclusions of law, and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the resolution.
Second.
Second by Vice Mayor Pierce. We'll turn it over to city staff first. Planner Bloom.
Honorable Mayor and City Council, this is a resolution which is sort of a final step in all of the other meetings we've had in regards to this 3rd Street project. Just to go back, on August 9th, we had a work session with the City Council and the consultants. We did the walking tour. We beat the rain, barely, and went to the depot, and we had finished up the work session there to discuss opportunities, constraints, and just typical planning exercise regarding 3rd Street. Then on February 14th, we did present a final draft document here at the City Council in a work session format. It was a wonderful Valentine's Day, so we presented that to everyone. On the 9th of March, we presented to the Traffic Commission for their acceptance, where they accepted this document. And then on the 13th of March, we brought forward a resolution to the Planning Commission for them to adopt this as an official plan of the city. So now what we're doing is bringing it through to its final step to adopt this as an official plan of the city, which is you to certify Planning Commission's action. Well, I wanted to point out a little bit about this plan, notably what it is. The intent of this document was to be a vision document, a giant wish list of desires saying we would like to see this on 3rd Street. We'd like to investigate public art. We'd like to investigate traffic calming measures, lane alterations, stuff like that. Ultimately, in the end, with this project, the ultimate decision maker is going to be the Wyoming Department of Transportation. It is their highway, it is their maintenance funds that will be funding this resurfacing project. If you look at this document, since the last time you saw it on February 14th, there was an addendum that was added by YDOT. This is the very last page of the longer document, which basically states what the scope of this maintenance project will be. It'll be storm drain repairs, replace damaged curb and gutter, replace ADA ramps at intersections, traffic signal and pavement replacement, and then crosswalk enhancements for signals. As a reminder, this is the entirety of 3rd Street, all the way from Curtis south to Boswell. So it's not just in our downtown. We have actually had additional meetings. This would be city staff, Laramie Main Street Alliance, YDOT, others in the city, regarding potential items we could pick from this plan and incorporate into the design. Some of those are bulb outs at some key intersections. Of course, this will all be dependent on the design for the vehicles and if the roadway could handle that. Some potential gateway treatments, whether those be signage above the roadway that would meet their requirements or medians. Potential for restricted left turns during peak hours. Basically, there would be several proposed intersections where left turns would be prohibited during the morning rush, the lunchtime, noon rush, 1 hour on either side, and the same in the evening. Also, there have been discussions about lowering of the speed limit for certain blocks in the downtown. That lowering of the speed limit would also go with a timing change on the signals that would essentially continue to give someone a green light if they're going the speed limit, which, believe it or not, all of our traffic lights on the streets are timed. So if you do go the speed limit, you shouldn't be catching red lights. So YDOT is in the early stages of designing this, so they would like to have any agreements on items that are agreed upon to be done by July 1st, 2017, which is pretty quick. So the next step after certification of this plan is city staff will work together with YDOT to make sure we get all of the other pieces in place and try to bring forward some other agreements. Now, YDOT is doing some early evaluations of bulb outs on intersections. I think they may have actually sent over some mock drawings. So there's the ability for this to happen. Those are items that they are looking at including in their design if they truly do function and they work for their project. I'm open to any questions you may have about the resolution. I know Trey Sherwood and Carly Ann Anderson, they are both here at Laramie Main Street Alliance, and I believe they dragged in half of the community with them as well. So with that, questions?
Thank you. Question specific for Mr. Bloom before I let Ms. Sherwood speak. Mr. Schuster?
Okay, so like we said, this is the state, so is all costs incurred right now by them?
Honorable Mayor and Councilor Schuster.
There's some gift by us, but there's most of the heavy costs are probably by the state.
For the most part, this maintenance project is to be completed and funded by the state. Some of the enhancements, such as bulb outs, including those in the early design, those are ones that the state is able to facilitate because those are being worked in early. If there are public art treatments, other types of things, those are what this July 1st agreement would need to identify. Where's that funding coming from? Where's this money coming from?
Okay, so we would have to come back to us probably then.
Correct.
And ask for funding for that. Thank you.
Any other questions just for Mr. Bloom? Councilor Gabriel?
Thank you, Mayor. So, Charles, if we have a conflict between what the city wants to do and what YDOT would like to do, not saying that we're going to have a conflict, but if we do have a circumstance such as that, then YDOT would prevail.
Honorable Mayor, Councilor Gabriel, that is correct.
Councilor Palikas?
Along the same line of Councilor Schuster, the cost, is there any cost estimates for our proportion at this point in time, or is that going to, you said something about July, that's going to happen in July of this year, or?
Mayor, through
what's
you,
that timeline?
There have not been any cost estimates that are provided or have been prepared yet.
Okay, so as a follow-up to that, will we be looking at cost estimates prior to the design of this project for our proportion of them?
Mayor, I believe that the next step, what we will be looking at is trying to figure out what pieces we could bite off and where we could look at allocating funding for. We do have a really short timeline before July to try to figure this out. So we'll see what, if any, that we can bite off and chew.
I think that was a yes.
Yeah, yes.
Councilor Hanson, another question for me.
Thank you, Your Honor. Specifically to what you just mentioned, I have some other concerns. To preface it, I've been advocating to couple two streets. I think what you pointed out is that this left turn on the street, I think is going to be a nightmare. When and where you can turn at what time, I think it's going to tax our citizens tremendously to find out what's permissible at what time. I think you also pointed out that this is going to have a central divider, sort of flower pots or whatever in the center, and that of course takes away from the width of the street. I still think the street was supposed to be pedestrian friendly. I think pedestrians, even with this middle strip to take a break in, will have a hard time crossing the street if you have traffic going in both directions. The issue that was raised before was the reduced number of parking spaces, and I don't think that has been sufficiently addressed, as we're going to have the same, or are we going to have less? It strikes me, from what I've seen as far as the design is concerned, we're going to have less. The other issue that occurs to me is that if we were at least advocating a coupling of two streets, we could conceivably enhance the downtown commercial area of this city, because you would develop two streets commercially. I know there has been some concern about acquisition of additional land or whatever on 4th Street. I'm not aware that we would have to. I think it generally would be more pedestrian friendly to have couplings that go one way and also avoid these turning issues into oncoming traffic, which in the downtown area, with a lot of traffic and a lot of turning, is going to be very cumbersome. So basically, I don't like the plan as it stands, and I just wanted to express that here, because I think it's not addressing the problems or the concerns that were raised, and it's not solving the problems that are existing now, and they will not be solved in any way, shape, or form. Thank you very much.
Any other questions for Planner Bloom?
Aren't you good?
Yeah. I do want to make sure we get to Ms. Sherwood here, so if just right. Questions that are specific to Mr. Bloom. If they're design questions or parking questions, I think we need to let Ms. Sherwood speak.
Do you want to answer him?
You can. I don't know if there's a question in there.
Honorable Mayor and Council, there were actually two points I think I was going to address, parking and the couplets. Parking under the proposals, there is no net loss in parking proposed mm-hmm. with this project. There The latest discussion with YDOT are preserving the lane alignments, and that involves some of those potential left turn restrictions, which would preserve parking as it is today. Even with the bulb outs, there were requirements for public work standards that you have a 20 or 30 foot no parking zone between the corner and the street. So those bulb outs would actually fit in the existing no parking areas. Regarding the couplets, there have been some recent discussions at our Urban System Advisory Committee to bring this item forward. From what we understand, YDOT is not looking to add mileage to their highway system at this time, and they weren't wanting to add a whole nother block of roadway. So there is a actual item on our Urban Systems Advisory Committee agenda in the near future, within the next few months, to discuss removing that whole couplet plan, to get rid of that whole couplet idea. There used to be a couplet idea that actually paralleled Grand with Grand and Garfield, and that was actually removed back in 2007. Mm-hmm. So we're beginning that discussion, but it's not a direction that most people are looking at going towards.
And there's no islands.
Correct. As shown in the plan, there is an island as a proposal. It's shown as a conceptual item that is sort of a placeholder, which shows that we could do some type of entrance treatment at that area, whether it be at Sheridan, whether it be at Clark. And that could either be an island, it could be an art piece on the side of the road, or it could be an archway. So there are a variety of different elements that could be incorporated, would not necessarily be an island.
All right.
I think Councilor Henry had a question before me.
I have a question. When you talk about when you say bulb outs, are you actually extending the curb line? I mean, is it a slope on the street? Is it painted on the street, or are you actually building up a curb? We've had a lot of emails about bulb outs.
Honorable Mayor and Councilor Henry, a bulb out actually is a curb extension that would just bumps out a little bit into the roadway. It doesn't impede the travel lane. It is what most people would call the parking lane. The closest item we have to a bulb out here is actually over on sort of 5th Street right here behind the detention center. You can see there's a bulb out that has been included that sort of is reserved for the parking for the sheriff's deputy vehicles. So it would be a curb extension that would extend into the corner of the street, so it would sort of push the sidewalk out.
In your opinion, would it affect the turning radius of certain vehicles with trailers, etc.?
Yeah. Honorable Mayor and Councilor Henry, YDOT actually is evaluating the bulb outs in a variety of different locations. City staff has provided them with some of our largest turning radius for their design vehicles, so they can make sure that those vehicles can move through the intersection. One intersection that's completely out, there are no bulb outs that would be proposed, would be Grand and Third. That is one where a lot of semi-trucks do go through, and they'd have trouble maneuvering. One that has been a candidate would be Third and Ivinson. I think that's one that YDOT has actually laid out a conceptual design based on our design vehicle, which is our largest fire truck, and it does show it still functions and works.
I had one other question.
Please do.
Is that okay?
Please.
On page 14 of the plan, it shows the proposed circulation diagram. Sorry. And I'm a little confused about the turning. You know, there's a picture. It's a yellow circle. It has two left turns, and it's got a red line through it, and it says no left turning movements. Maybe I understand it now if I read it out loud. So never mind. So those are the ones where they're proposing no left turns during certain times of the day, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. I understand now. Thank you.
Councilor Perkins.
The question I had is for the no left turns for part of the day, how does that, is that through a street light? Is that through a warning sign as part of this? How does that function?
Honorable Mayor and Councilor Palikas, that actually is a sign that would illuminate during those peak periods. So it would light up and look like a no left turn sign. In Cheyenne, there's one on Lincoln Way. Right when you come into town on Lincoln Way, there's a no right turn line light that illuminates for the railroad crossing. So it would be similar to that.
So I'm aware of that. So that's what it would look like?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
And if it could be programmed as well, based on actual demand or need, so it could be changed.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for city staff? Okay, thank you very much. Mm-hmm. I invite Director of Main Street, Trey Sherwood. And Carly Ann Anderson as well. Welcome.
Good evening. Thank you for your time. Really, we're here to thank you for your consideration and your efforts and answer any questions that you might have for us. Carly and I have prepared a snapshot of the steps that we've taken to get to this point. This was a refresher about the engagement we've had with you, with the public, with our stakeholders, training that we've undertaken to understand best practices. And I'm excited here. I mean, 2017 is going to be an amazing year for our community as we move forward on the Empress and 3rd Street, and we're really becoming more sophisticated in our planning and our action, and it's hard to contain our excitement here. Carly, do you want to add anything?
Yes, I was going to say we're happy to take any questions, but just to address some of the concerns we've heard tonight, I wanted to mention that we've been really encouraged with all of the negotiations that we've done through our community partners, and especially with YDOT. We've sat at the table with them multiple times, and we've had consistently YDOT representatives at all of our meetings. So I think as we go forward, there will be plenty of opportunities to negotiate opportunities for funding and enhancements along the corridor. I don't think any doors are closed on July 1st. I just know that they really need to start getting things on paper for their planning process. Also, we're really planning on doing as much public engagement and good signage as possible to address these concerns, both before the plan is implemented and as these road enhancements occur. So we're trying as hard as possible to make sure that those left hands are as clear as possible so that people know how they can still get into downtown turning left. But really, the purpose of restricting those left-hand turns is to decrease the number of T-bone accidents that we're seeing on 3rd Street. And we have kind of an alarming number of those, and that's the most dangerous type of car accident to have. And you see that as people sort of try to sneak forward and see around the cars. So almost everything that we've proposed throughout this major are focused on safety enhancements and safety measures. Also, I would say that we have a strong history and track record of doing excellent public-private partnerships for funding on this road, and we will continue to do that through partnerships with our business community and others, property owners. And
I should say, in terms of the funding issue, we're not going to step away from the table. Main Street will be here to be scrappy, to find the resources. As a nonprofit, we can move in different directions than the city can. And I already have a grant application in for the wayfinding portion of this plan.
Yeah, we're excited for wayfinding. That's one of the best ways to sort of map our entire community and make sure people know where they're going, whether there are students coming into town, tourists coming in the summer, whatever it might be. And all the rest of us, too. We need to know where we're going. I will point out that the width of the street will not change. Laramie is not one of these communities who was lucky enough to historically have, say, a rail line or a streetcar line going down the street, so we really are hemmed in on either side by the width of that street. And so that's one reason that we don't see wider sidewalks. We're just going for curb extensions, bumping into that parking lane, and we are really focused on not losing any of that parking because we do recognize how important that is to our businesses along the 3rd Street corridor. So those curb extensions will extend into the parking lane, but again, we are designing around Laramie's largest fire truck with the idea that a fire truck can make it without that hinge. Semi-trucks, tow trucks, all the other large vehicles in the community should also be able to make it. So those will only be within, I think it's about 10 feet of the curb, and you're technically not supposed to be parking within 30 feet of that area. And then I think for the, that's probably about it. I think I addressed funding concerns at the beginning. So we'd be happy to take any other questions you might have.
Questions for Main Street? All right. Thank you. You guys are off the hook.
Like a ladder truck.
Bloom took all of it.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
So take some public comments before we have our discussion up here. So I'm going to open up to public comment. Mr. Glass? And I want to remind everybody, I know there's a lot of people here to speak on the 3rd Street issue, so we're going to have a five-minute time limit and ask everybody to try to be respectful of what the other speakers said and not be repetitive if we can at all manage it, so we make sure we get everybody's points across tonight.
Yes, Honorable Mayor.
And also, sorry, one more thing. Please sign the sheet that is on the table behind the city clerk after you speak and introduce yourself for the record.
Yes, okay. Honorable Mayor, members of council, my name is Brett Glass. My family owns property downtown. We're trying to improve it. Our properties would like to see downtown flourish, and we're concerned about certain elements of this plan. As I mentioned in a letter that was printed to the Boomerang a couple of weeks ago, one of the things we're concerned about is the traffic circulation. If someone is interested in coming downtown at rush hour under the current plan, and they miss turning into town at Garfield Street and don't realize that they have to, they, under this plan, if you take a look at this circulation diagram, will not be able to turn left at Ivinson, University, or Fremont. They will be diverted all the way up to Clark Street, if they have the patience to do that, where there won't be a left turn lane, and they will probably have to wait through cycles of the light and deal with oncoming traffic. This is a big concern. We really don't want to wall off downtown from people who are coming into downtown and trying to get there. And so this is a major concern. In real life, it's going to be extremely frustrating and may discourage people from getting downtown. I think it was asserted earlier that there are a lot of T-bone accidents. That's true, but it seems to be, at least in my experience, where I have had near misses and narrowly avoided someone coming at me, it's been because they ran a light, not because somebody was turning left. But in any case, I'd like you to look carefully at this circulation diagram, and seriously, do not approve this plan unless this is modified such that people won't be horribly frustrated. The same is true of the median down the middle. The median down the middle may, so some people may think that would look pretty, but it would eliminate the use of that block as part of a parade route, which it frequently is right now. And it would restrict vision. There are some serious concerns there. So before we do that, I'd like to ask that you consider that carefully. The second issue, which is really key to all of us who have to deal with downtown, is parking. It was asserted in the Boomerang and elsewhere that there isn't going to be any parking lost. But if you take a look at the actual diagrams in this document, you can see that quite a lot of parking is lost. And I'd like to hand this out. This is an enlargement of the diagrams that are small and sort of hard to see from the document.
Mr. Glass, if you could hand that to the city clerk, please.
I'd be glad to hand that to the clerk to distribute, if you'd rather do it that way.
That's have her job.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. As you can see from this blow-up, the plan, as it shows the parking and shows what will happen to it, and this is unavoidable because of the way they're talking about rearranging the lanes, would lose us a full half block of parking, actually more than a half a block, right in front of some businesses that desperately need it. A couple in particular where their properties have had trouble keeping businesses because there wasn't available parking in the area. We'll also, because of the trees that would be added at the corner of Grand, lose several more spaces right there, and that is an area where people frequently circle the block looking for parking. Those trees, by the way, are part of, it says in the document, something called a peekaboo treatment, where they planted trees so that they obstruct the view of downtown. It seems to me this is absolutely the opposite of what we want. We want people to be able to see, here's downtown, see that the businesses are there. With our sign code, the signs can't be very big. You want people to be able to see things. We don't want to play peekaboo with our downtown. We want people to be able to see what's there. So in any case, these are the main concerns that I see in the plan, and I urge you not to rubber stamp it, to look at things like this and address it. One way to address some of these problems would be to consider Councillor Hansen's idea of making a one-way couplet. This works in other cities. It works in Cheyenne. It works in Loveland. So we actually have local, we can actually have towns we can visit and look at how it works and, you know, do the right thing. The other thing is it basically gives us more room for things. If we have the one-way couplet, suddenly we have much more, the equivalent of additional two lanes that can be made into more parking rather than less. We can make things more pedestrian friendly because pedestrians only have to look one way. We have more room for bicycles. In general, it's really something worth considering, and I know that some people have said that they're skeptical about it, but I really think that we should look at how this might work. But even if we don't consider the one-way couplets, I urge you to address these other things because I think that they're very necessary to making sure that we have a positive effect on downtown rather than a negative one. And with that, I probably come to my 5 minutes. So
you have
thank you
exactly.
Very much.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Ross. I appreciate it. Sir in the black shirt, I believe you were next. Please come forward. Welcome.
Thank you. Honorable Mayor, members of the council, my name's Tim Woodward. I own the Subway Bagel Makers in Qdoba on the block of 3rd and Fremont. The no left turn thing at lunch and breakfast will take away from my business, obviously. It's really tough to get in there. We'd be happy to give up the parking spaces in front of the store, but the no left turn really will drive down our business. That's my only concern. We do have about 700 people a day that eat at those three shops. That's why I was saying if we do want a turn lane, that's fine. But the no left turn thing would hurt my business. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else that would like to speak? Please.
Good evening, Madam Mayor, the City Council. My name is Diane Berner, and I reside downtown on 3rd Street. My front door pretty much stares at Grand and 3rd Street. I am an active volunteer since the day I moved back to Laramie with Main Street, so I am slightly biased as a volunteer. However, I will share with you what I shared with the planning proposal group that we came to. I am a graduate of this university. I graduated from here in 1983. And while there have been many improvements and modifications to Laramie as a whole, as now a resident again, potential business owner, and parent of a freshman at our fine university, it's kind of bizarre that our downtown, right at Grand and 3rd Street, looks pretty much like it did 30-some-odd years ago. I believe that our town has a lot of potential, and I believe that we are stepping up to that potential. One of the things that drew us to relocating back here versus maybe another college town about an hour to the south of us is just the very welcoming nature of the people and the volunteers and what we had to offer. On the negative side, I would say, and this is almost in response to Mr. Glass, excuse me, sir, the trees. There's no foliage really down in that area. We have a park that has parking, and it's way back behind. It would be nice to see a little bit of beautification. I was in Torrington 2 weeks ago, and it doesn't necessarily have to be down the middle of the road, but I noticed that even at their major intersection, it was off to the side. There was an area that had a sculpture and a little bit about Torrington. It was very attractive, very appealing. As far as parking goes, we may or may not lose a space or two or three or four or what have you. And at the risk of, I'm just gonna lead with my chin as I often do. I live above a business, or that was a business up until last weekend. And it's my understanding that there have been several businesses that come in and out of there. And I can appreciate that. But I would tell you that during essentially a fire sale, when items in the store were $1, people had no problem with parking two blocks away and walking down. And that's really unfortunate, because if those people had had that same attitude much earlier on, another business might still be there. So yes, parking is an issue. However, if you look at the plans for what they're doing, say, in large metropolitan areas, they're looking to recreate that small town feel. which is what we have here, where they'll have, people can live in their area, shop, eat, and everything, but it's just, that's what we're, I believe that Main Street is trying to, is to create, is that, oh, sorry, my train left the station, it's come back now, but, and it just left again. Sorry, I'm just going to skip it. Well, it creates that walking feel. Even some of the malls, believe it or not, they're not indoor malls anymore. They're outdoor malls. Doesn't matter if it's down in Florida or even up in the north, say up in Minneapolis. So it's how we present it. It's how we market it and to get the buy-in. And those are all beautification type things. But I would say, of course, the health and well-being of our people and driving safety and pedestrian safety. The good news with the left turn lights is that they can be adjusted, but it's just from my understanding, we'll be able to adjust those. And if this is, this proclamation is just to go forth to YDOT here, I might be misunderstanding it, but to go and say, yes, we're on board with this project and we can negotiate our way forward. If we're on YDOT's docket for 2020 and funding is as unpredictable as it is these days, if we've got it, we need to jump on it. We can negotiate the finer points of it. Is it a bridge? Is it an island? Is it a sculpture? Is it a painting? We can work the little things out, but if we've got money from YDOT for 2020, if we don't take that now, we've lost out. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please, sir.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor and respected members of the council. My name is Ben McKay. I am a member of the Planning Commission that this document recently came through. However, tonight I'm here speaking to you as a private citizen and then also as an employee of Handle Information Technologies, just a block that way. Both the company I work for, our CEO, and myself are strongly in favor of this plan. We would love to see the types of things that we accomplished with our downtown building accomplished with other buildings. And I think one of the key parts of this plan and this process that Ms. Sherwood has really focused on and done a fantastic job with is that private-public relationship that she's forming with these businesses. I also feel that right now, our downtown gateway, it feels like a town was just kind of plopped on top of a highway. It doesn't feel like an entrance to a downtown. I've been part of this planning process pretty much since it began its public process. There are a few misconceptions that I do just want to make sure are cleared up because they've been discussed at length in these meetings. There's no loss to parking. There's not a median running all the way down 3rd Street. Peekaboo treatments, even though they sound like it's a little pinhole that you're looking through to try to peek into downtown, they're really more to lure people. It's marketing for downtown to draw people in, to make our entrances to downtown attractive. And so I do really, really encourage you to look at this plan. It's well put together, but it's not a finalized plan. It's simply an opportunity for us to come to the table and talk with YDOT where we otherwise wouldn't have an opportunity. So with that in mind, I really, really encourage you, please vote for this plan. There's been a lot of work put into it, and it offers our community a fantastic, really once-in-a-generation chance to come to the table with the state and have our downtown look the way that we want it to. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Oh, Mr. McKay, could I have you sign in? Thank you so much. Anyone else like to offer public comment? Please come forward.
Hello, my name is Eric Milliken. I'm a civil engineer for the city of Laramie. I just started back in August. And just to give you a little background about my education, I got my master's here at the University of Wyoming in civil engineering with an emphasis in traffic. I worked in downtown Denver for 2 years at HDR, and I've also worked here at Dow doing traffic work for more rural communities. I'd just like to emphasize that this plan is a wish list. None of this is set in stone. The purpose of this plan is to get YDOT to look at it. they're going to look at left turn prohibition. There's no operational or safety analysis done yet. But when YDOT starts looking at it, they will do an alternatives analysis with different layouts for Third Street for couplets, for bulb outs, for removing parking, for keeping all of the parking there. And they will try to improve it. None of this is set in stone, and I urge you to vote to approve it.
Thank you very much. Other public comment? Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to pick on you on that.
Of course. I'm Judy Snoke. I'm a regular attender and a regular driver of Third Street. And I have a concern, and it's not about this plan. It's about and I don't know how or to whom appropriately to address this. We are losing so many businesses, and we look decrepit. When you come in, there's nothing in it. We lost Boot Barn, we lost, well, one place that was no loss, but farther out, Third Street and even in the north and then in toward the south, we look sad. We do not look like we are a booming community, and I don't know what can be done to improve it or how to encourage businesses to change their face so that something looks more appealing. And I'm, much as I love trees, I don't know that putting trees in is necessarily going to do the trick. I think it's going to take some serious economic development. And so that's all I have to say about this. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
And if you have a suggestion for me to where to go with my concern, I'll take it.
I think we got it here. Anyone else for public comment on this item? Going once? Please. Only got to one.
Jerry.
Mayor, City Council. My name is Jerry Schmidt, and I've been working in the downtown as a volunteer for about 12 years. I've been the chairman of the DDA, chairman of Main Street, and on other committees in the town. My wife has a business over on Second. I think what the winning part of this is that one of the things that's really the hardest to do in public when it comes to public interest is melding the different missions and goals that different agencies have. We have, in this case, YDOT has a goal and a mission that's in public's interest to manage our highways. We have a mission and objectives and goals to take good care of our city. In downtown, with our Main Street, we have a goal to increase the social and economic vitality, preserve the history, make that a better place, a good asset for the entire community. And I think what this process is doing is bringing it together to where people are working together to try to accomplish their goals, but respect the other goals and missions as well. And I think that's the real winning part of this proposal, and I hope for that reason you'll support it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else for public comment? Please, sir.
Howdy, my name is Harrison Welshimer, and I'm a student. Well, I was a student, so I wanted to talk about the brain drain that we see occurring from Wyoming. And I was part of that. I went down to, I went all over, but I settled in Denver. And what you're seeing in communities to our south, very close, it is not hard for young Wyoming people just to go 60 miles south. And you're seeing these communities, they have very exciting downtowns. They're very vibrant. They're places you want to spend time. And so this seems like an amazing opportunity to me for us to put our flavor of what it means to welcome you to our community. So while I like those downtowns, I don't like the people as much. That's why I like Wyoming, right? I mean, that's why I'm here. But it does seem like our Third Street is not welcoming people to get to know us as well. You kind of have to take the initiative to get down to, you know, Second Street parking is, you know, I understand the issues there, but we need some kind of vibrant hello, welcome to Laramie. We want you to stick around for a little bit. Check us out. And I am intrigued. I'm a little new to the technicalities of what is in this proposal, but I am intrigued about the ideas of a one-way on 4th, if I'm understanding the coupling idea, one-way on 3rd and one-way on 4th. Mr. Bloom said that's maybe off the table, but it is intriguing because it seems to me that would be there would be flow on either side, and there might be potential for increasing walkways and also pedestrian flow working with that. It's if I know you guys have a lot on your plate, so I respect that, but maybe if there is a way to look at, would that potentially be the best way to make pedestrian improvements, but also while increasing traffic flow at the same time, win-win. So that's my comment.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Anyone else for public comment? Going once, twice. All right, I'm going to close public comment. We'll take it back to council. So let's go to comments for council. Councillor Hanson.
Thank you. I just have a question for the planners. If I remember right, and you can answer yes or no, are there bicycle paths on the design for 3rd Street?
No bicycle paths.
Thank you. That answers one of my questions, because I think we're trying to the point of including bicycles as a mode of transportation, and then one of the main roads, the business area, we're taking them out. Why? Because 3rd Street, as wide as it is, it ain't wide enough for everything. This is why I'm coming from, and please don't misunderstand me. I'm perfectly fine, and I support making it more beautiful. Yes, but you know, the street just isn't wide enough for all the things we want to do, and it's going to look cramped. And if you think it's going to be attractive, I don't think it's going to be that attractive, quite frankly. So I'm still opposing this plan. Thank you.
I'm just going to go around the dais here. Councillor Schuster.
Okay. This is a wish list, this document is. And we have till 2020, and things can be added or taken away. Things I hope to see is where we get to Grand and Third is if we can do something with that intersection for a little bit of beautification. I don't think the trees are going to be a problem. Right now, it's hard to think that you're going to come up off of Grand Avenue and turn on 3rd Street without a green light. There is so much traffic flowing on it, you basically have to wait for your light. That's just a fact of the way it is. I was on council when the first time we tried to build a Harney Street overpass. A lot of people don't remember this. This was back in 2006. It's now 2017. We voted to delay it and do another study, and the state now has finally came back 10 years later and offered funding again. And we're now started on it. I want to see this plan move forward. If we don't sign it, we don't have this in place in July, anybody that votes against it says, okay, we'll just delay 3rd Street by 10 years, just like if you voted to delay the overpass. So on this, do I support? I support 100%. Do I wish that somehow we're going to come up with some funding to do more enhancements? That would be great. But these stoplights they are putting on in are good stoplights. We're saying that we may say may not be able to turn here at this street. When I listened to the state, did they ever say that they were going to say you would not be able to make a left-hand turn for 4 blocks? They said no. They said if we do it, we will do it every other block. So if you can't turn on Ivanson, that means at the next street light, you can. They would not turn all 4 of them on at the same time. These are smart lights. What's really good, they'll be in constant communication. Can they at any time adjust the times or not turn on the no left turn? That would be correct. They could say that, we really don't need it at this intersection, and it will be fine for people to make a left-hand turn. So a lot of things we were talking about. There are no islands. I've heard islands mentioned like 6 times. There are no islands proposed. They said if there was an island, it would be for a half a block, and it would either be on the north end of town or the south end of town. It will not be at Grand and Third. There'll be no islands there. They'll be 20 blocks away on each side if they did anything where there is more room. But it's a good plan. It's a good start. Would it help more if, just like they said, if people improved the fronts of their buildings? Yes. That's what will help attractive downtown more than anything else. And new curb, because some of the curb and some of the handicap cuts, they're not even there or they're in terrible shape. So what YDOT is going to do is going to be a good plan for a start. We need to keep it going. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Plikas.
Yeah, thank you. I like the comment that someone made about Third Street, that it really hasn't changed in the last 40 years. I think I can support that comment in a big way. It really hasn't changed, and I think this plan is a great plan. I mean, I think whatever we can afford to do, I think it'll be well worthwhile as far as what Third Street will look like. But I do have a couple of concerns, and I just want to make sure they're on the record, because some of these concerns, they're just concerns at this point in time. Probably the largest one is our funding mechanism. We're going to be short on funding. It's going to be a challenge. The more sources we can have for funding, the better off we're going to be. In other words, I'll use the example of the DDA. The DDA has the means to tax itself for its downtown district. By golly, I think at some point in time, the downtown businesses need to look at themselves and consider themselves a village, if you will, and realize that neighborhood is only going to improve to the level they want it to improve if they're willing to invest in themselves. It was very close last time it went to a vote, and I'm hoping that something like that comes about again, and they support that. But the financing of our enhancements are going to be critical as to what the plan's finding eventually going to look like, and I think that needs to be addressed at a very, very early part of the discussion. The left-hand turns is my major, major concern. If I had three businesses on a corner at an intersection, and I don't care if you're not allowing me left-hand turn, anytime you're not allowing people to make a left-hand turn into my business, you're taking away some of my business from me. And that type of investment that I would have made, excuse me, in our community, I think we need to pay really strong attention to it. We need to make sure that we do everything we can to continue to make those businesses successful. And I think left-hand turns do have the ability to take away an awful lot of business. We just can't do that to people. We can't do that to people that have invested in our invested in our downtown and now are going to end up with less business. The parking. Parking's an interesting issue downtown. I think we can solve that problem real easy if we want to. We just need to make sure the people that are parking downtown or they're shopping downtown and not other and we have the ability to do that. The DDA has the ability to do that, especially if they tax themselves. It's an easy, solvable problem if we really want to solve it, is my opinion on it. And then the last thing I want to talk about is the speed limits. I think we have to be very careful on speed limits for a number of reasons. If you slow things down too much, you create more congestion. Number one. Number two, if you slow things down, and I'll use the university example on 15th Street. You put a radar on 15th Street, and the average person on 15th Street by the university dorms is not going 20 miles an hour. They're going 25 or sometimes 30 because it's comfortable to them. The other part that happens is sometimes when you slow speed limits down too slow, you end up with so much congestion that people go to other streets. They alleviate it. I use Garfield an awful lot because I use Garfield because I don't need to use Grand, and Garfield's quicker, given the amount of congestion on Garfield. The same thing can happen on Third Street. So these are the concerns I have, but don't misconstrue what I'm saying. I fully support the idea of changing Third Street and anything we can do to help our businesses downtown and enhance our community aesthetically. I'm in full support of it. So thank you.
Councilor Shumway, any comments?
Thank you, Your Honor. I don't want to repeat what DePalika said, I think we agree on the same concerns. I came here with six. I think they've all been addressed. I do want to move forward. I remember when I was on council and we had the sad discussion about not continuing with the Harney Street overpass. I was strongly in favor of moving forward then. It didn't happen. We would already have that overpass here if it hadn't done that. I don't want to stop this. I don't want to slow this down. I want to move forward, and so I do support the proposal that's before us and look forward to the improvements and corrections that are going to be necessary to make this happen.
Vice Mayor.
Yeah, I'm going to support this. I think the only thing I'd like to add to the conversation is, as much as I agree with Councillor Hansen in terms of trying to get 4th Street worked out in some manner or form, it then turns into a YDOT project. And YDOT funds are limited. Wyoming funds are limited. So we go forward with what we can get, and that's what we're going to do.
Councillor Gabriel?
Well, once again, not to repeat what everybody else has said, Joe, Dave, Brian, I agree. Of all the emails we received, the one that drew my most concern was Mr. Woodward's on about turning left, going north. And so, you know, like everybody's talked about, this is a vision document. There's time to make changes in it. I'm in favor of it. Let's move ahead. And we've got some time to make, hopefully, the right decisions for everybody, and let's see what happens.
Councillor Henry.
Yes, I'm going to support this wholeheartedly. I was noticing that the stoplight, I'm looking at the traffic circulation diagram. There's a traffic light on Clark Street, and that is going to be taken down when they remove the bridge, which is in like 2018, 2019. So I don't see why we would need to have a no left turn on Fremont Street, because I think that's part of the reason that they would like to do that, because it's always so jammed up when you come to Clark Street and there's a line way back. Well, there won't be anybody turning. Well, there might be some people turning, but it won't be like it is now, where you're turning onto the viaduct. So I don't think you need to worry about it. I think we can work through that. Another thing I would like to see is a 25 mile speed limit extended northward all the way to Harney Street, mainly to me because of the difficulty in crossing the road when people are trying to get to Safeway from the east side of the road. That's really, really dangerous. But other than that, I love the plan, and I like all the public comments that went into it and all the workshops and all that. And thank you, Trey, for heading this project up. And I'm going to vote yes.
Before I make my comments, does any other member of council have any other additional comments or need any clarification on anything? Okay. So I just wanted to say a couple of things. So I think we all have to remember, somebody told me once that if you're having a good day and you drive on 3rd Street and you get to Clark and 3rd Street at 5 o'clock, you're no longer having a good day. And I don't care what
you're driving or whatever, it just doesn't matter. Between Grand and Clark is especially bad on 3rd Street. So remember that we have seen issues. We have safety issues. We all know this. We're trying to make those changes. I think it's very important to realize that we can still change things in the future. I know that the one-way couplet has been something that comes up continuously. It came up 10 years ago. It came up tonight. So I'm not a traffic engineer, but I think that involves some paint and 4th Street. So if that comes up, I don't think that moving forward with this and doing the changes that we can right now that YDOT is willing to accede to, that doesn't kill that conversation. So if it comes out in the future that that's something that the community needs to do, I think that's still an option. Even if, you know, we move forward with this 2020 plan, maybe in 2025 or 2030, it makes sense to have one-way couplets. I don't know. But I think that the importance of this plan is that we're starting with these low-hanging fruit items that we can do to make improvements right now so that we don't have to wait another 15 years or 20 years for another opportunity to come by. So, and I really appreciate everybody's focus on kind of that 30,000 foot level on this. I know I don't share a lot of the concerns that some of you guys do with turn lanes and bulb outs and that kind of stuff. I've had the opportunity to attend one of these trainings with the traffic engineers. I've been to a lot of these conversations that they've had. This is an impressive list of community outreach, to be sure. And so I've seen, we have really good experts from all of these stakeholder groups that know what they're doing. And I'm not a traffic engineer, so I'm going to let them do their jobs. And I just want to commend Main Street, because without their stepping up and Trey and Carly Ann stepping up to start this and form, they took the initiative 18 months, 24 months ago, formed a diverse group of stakeholders, had the vision to see that this was the timing, and they are the ones that have put together one of the most cooperative projects with YDOT I think this community has ever seen with this plan. YDOT has been to all of these meetings, they're talking, they're open to changes, and that is something that we have not traditionally seen. So I think that's really important. So I hope everybody supports it, and I'll leave it at that. Any other comments from council? City Clerk, roll call, please.
Henry.
Yes.
McKinney, absent. Pelegas.
Yes.
Shumway.
Yes.
Schuster.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Hansen.
No.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That is 7 yeses, 1 no, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. And I also want to add for the record, I would encourage those people that have had concerns to reach out to Main Street, as I see is going on in the aisle right now, and make sure that they are aware of your concerns. All right, moving on to the next item on the agenda is item 11A. Councillor Henry.
11A.
That is 8H from the consent agenda.
I have. So do I move to approve it, or
just you have to put it on the floor? So move to approve it on third reading. Read the sheet that's on there.
So I move to approve original ordinance number 1961 on third and final reading in accordance with findings of fact and conclusions of law, and authorize the mayor and clerk to sign the ordinance.
Second. Second by the vice mayor, and I'll turn it back to you.
I move to postpone this ordinance to a future date.
2 weeks.
April 18th.
2 weeks.
April 18th.
April 18th. April 18th. I move to postpone this original ordinance number 1961 to April 18th.
Second.
2017.
Thank you. Second by Vice Mayor on the postponement. Any discussion or comments on the postponement?
Gabriel.
Yes.
Hansen.
Yes.
Henry.
Yes.
McKinney, absent. Pelegas.
Yes.
Shumway.
Yes.
Schuster.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That is 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. We will consider that at our next regular business meeting. Item number 12 is Councillor Schuster.
Thank you. The title of this original ordinance is number 1962. City staff to carry out obligations of the city as approved by the City Council. I move to approve on second reading original ordinance number 1962, adding ordinance 2.08.025 to the Laramie Municipal Code to make certain that the authority of the city manager and the city staff to carry out the obligations of the city as approved by the City Council.
Second. Second by Councillor Shumway. City Attorney, any updates or further information on this?
No, Your Honor. This is as was brought before you on the first reading to give me comfort and city manager and staff comfort that the loop is closed when you vote to approve something, that the staff has the authority to carry it out.
Questions? All right. Thank you. Any comments from the public on this item? Comments from City Council on this item? City Clerk? Council
just Hansen. One comment. I think we made it before. This is always at the request of the City Council, and that's the way I think it is conceived. And the City Manager will, of course, consult with the City Council on decisions that are to be made.
Thank you.
Mayor, Council, that yes, this would not change that. It's carefully written that it is only on matters approved by City Council.
Council, correct.
Any further comments?
No.
City Clerk, roll call, please.
Schuster.
Yes.
Shumway.
Yes.
Polikas.
Yes.
McKinney, absent. Henry.
Yes.
Hansen.
Yes.
Gabriel.
Yes.
Pierce.
Yes.
Somerville.
Yes.
That's 8 yeses, 0 noes, and 1 absent, Your Honor.
Thank you. That motion carries. On to item number 13, which is public comments on non-agenda items. Do we have any members of the public that would like to speak on non-agenda items? All right. Seeing none, we'll move to item number 14, which is consideration of future council work session topics. Do we have any? Councilor Perkins?
Actually, I was going to put in the taxi ordinance. Our discussion of it, and I noticed it's already in there. And the other one I'm interested in, I talked briefly about it last time, is sometime in the future. I realize it may be a couple months down the road, but I would like to explore the possibility of us relinquishing our authority on the Civic Center Joint Powers Board.
Is there support for that?
Feasibility.
Oh, I'd be much in support of that.
Then let's go ahead and add that to the work session list. So,
and I understand that it may be down the road a ways.
Civic Center.
It's not time sensitive.
Okay. All right. And would you get with city staff on any particulars you want to discuss about that financial whatever, so we make sure we cover everything that you would like?
I'd be glad to.
Perfect. Any other work sessions that council members would like to see? Okay. I don't have anything substantial on the scheduling changes either. So, Councilor Hanson.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move that council.
Hold on, just, I'm sorry. So sorry.
Please, I'm sorry.
Councilor Gabriel, did I skip something for you?
No, I just wanted to point something out before we adjourn to executive, if I could.
Please.
And maybe I should have brought this up during our proclamations, but many of us saw the newspaper article that Ike did last Friday in the newspaper about the two individuals that picked up all the green waste at 9th and Russell. So I reached out to Shane Brown and talked to him today, expressing my appreciation for picking up that, taking it to the dump, using the bags that he bought himself at Ace Hardware, over 130 bags of green waste that he took. And then while he was doing that, Roy Nelson came over to help him. He didn't know the guy and just said that, you know, he wanted to help out because he had driven past 9th and Russell so many times and seen this green waste that kind of got to him on eyesore. So I just expressed my appreciation for doing something like that. And Mr. Brown didn't want to have any kind of recognition, really, because I was kind of encouraging him to come to the council meeting, and he said that he just wanted to do something to help the city. And so I told him that I would do something in recognition of what he did, and that I would write a check to the soup kitchen in both Mr. Brown and Mr. Nelson's name, expressing appreciation for their work, and they said that would be great.
Appreciate that. Thank you, Councilor Gabriel. Councilor Schuster?
I've had a couple of people ask when the green waste containers are coming out.
That would be April 24th, I believe. City manager?
Mayor, that's correct. We have press out on that, and it's on our city website. That's
2 days after cleanup day.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Continue to clean up.
All right. Councilor Hanson, now you're up.
Thank you, Your Honor. Better late than never, right? I move that council adjourn to executive session regarding personnel, referring to paragraph 16-4-405, exception X, and potential litigation, referring to city code, paragraph 16-4-405, exception. That is supposed to be Roman numeral 3.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by the Vice Mayor. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We are adjourned.